The Lord is our light and our salvation. The Lord is the stronghold of our life. Let us seek the Lord's face in this time of worship. Let us honor God's presence in our prayers and in our praises. Welcome to worship with Cornerstone and Westminster on this, the second Sunday of Lent 2022. I'd like to thank our helpers today. Jan for the recording and editing once again, Jerry for special music, and Amanda for hymns. I'd also like to thank Donna for the decorations in the sanctuary, and a reminder that we have the blue and yellow flowers here, helping us to keep in mind the people of Ukraine. It is very important that as we continue our prayers for one another in this difficult time, that we keep them foremost in our prayers. Let's begin our worship today with prayer. Let us pray. God, ever creating, ever loving, ever leading, when things around us feel chaotic, you are peace. When so much we hear is not reliable, your word is truth. When we're paralyzed by fear and anxiety, your presence is freedom. When we feel bereft and helpless, your love gives us hope. God, you are the source of all that matters. We bring you our prayers and our praise this day. For you reveal yourself to us in the goodness of creation, in the love and mercy of Christ, your beloved, and through the energy and wisdom of the Holy Spirit. We worship you, O God, ever three and ever one, world without end. God of compassion, we are creatures who seek our own comfort. We confess that we prefer our own plans to your purposes. We shrink from discipleship and put our own interests first. Forgive our fleeting commitment and the times we've indulged our own complaints. Have mercy on us. Inspire us with the energy to do your will and serve our neighbors in the example of Christ, your Son and our Lord. Amen. Friends, in Christ, while it is true that we have all sinned, it's a greater truth that we're forgiven through God's love poured out in Jesus Christ. To all who humbly seek the mercy of God, I say, in Jesus Christ, our sin is forgiven. Be at peace with God, with yourself, and with one another. I Our Old Testament reading today is the story of God making a covenant with Abraham. It was a very important link in the religious tradition of Israel. Reading from Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 to 12, and verses 17 and 18. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abraham said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and count the stars if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Then he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But he said, O Lord God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? He said to him, Bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. He brought him all these and cut them in two, laying each half over against the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. And when the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abraham drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and a deep and terrifying darkness descended on him. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, To your descendants, I give this land, from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates. And our epistle reading is from the letter to the Philippians. Paul writes here about a problem that we share with them, how to live as disciples of Jesus Christ in a hostile environment in which the majority of our neighbors do not share our beliefs and convictions. Paul's advice was to follow his example as he followed Christ in living in this world, but with totally different values to guide them in the world, but not of it. Reading from Philippians chapter 3, verse 17 to chapter 4, verse 1. Brothers and sisters, join in imitating me and observe those who live according to the example you have in us. For many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. I have often told you of them, and now I tell you, even with tears. Their end is destruction, their God is the belly, and their glory is in their shame. Their minds are set on earthly things, but our citizenship is in heaven, and it is from there that we are expecting a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. He will transform the body of our humiliation that it may be conformed to the body of his glory, by the power that also enables him to make all things subject to himself. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved.
Precious memories, unseen angels sent from somewhere to my soul. How they linger ever near me, and the sacred sacred past unfolds. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold. Precious Father, loving Mother, fly across the lonely years, and old home, scenes of my childhood, in fond memories appear. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold. I remember Mother praying, Father too on bended knees. The sun is sinking, shadows falling, but their prayers seem to follow me. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold.
As we continue our Lenten journey this Lenten season, remember that the focus of our messages is God's command from the clouds on the Mount of Transfiguration: listen to him. We found it easy to listen to Christ's words on the Mount of Transfiguration when he was overwhelmed by the glory and the cloud around, the dazzling clothes, the glowing face. Everything was really, really positive. It was also easy enough in the wilderness watching Christ stand up to Satan and hearing his words of reproach to the devil. But as we listen to the gospel today from Luke 11, our listening becomes in some ways a little painful for us. The Jesus that we see in this passage, instead of being a loving, caring Jesus, suddenly becomes confrontational. We join Jesus here still fairly early in his ministry, although things have changed since the temptation in the wilderness. Jesus has now called his disciples together. He has already performed miracles of healing. He's begun teaching his disciples and the crowds. And today, we find him invited to dine at the home of one of the Pharisees. Here we read from Luke chapter 11, verses 37 to 52. While he was speaking, a Pharisee invited him to dine with him, so he went in and took his place at the table. The Pharisee was amazed to see that he did not first wash before dinner. Then the Lord said to him, Now, you Pharisees clean the outside of the cup and of the dish, but inside you are full of greed and wickedness. You fools, did not the one who made the outside make the inside also? So give for alms those things that are within, and see, everything will be clean for you. But woe to you, Pharisees, for you tithe mint and rue and herbs of all kinds, and neglect justice and the love of God. It is these you ought to have practiced, without neglecting the others. Woe to you, Pharisees, for you love to have the seat of honor in the synagogues and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces. Woe to you, for you are like unmarked graves, and people walk over them without realizing it. One of the lawyers answered him, "Teacher, when you say these things, you insult us too." And he said, "Woe also to you lawyers, for you load people with burdens hard to bear, and you yourselves do not lift a finger to ease them. Woe to you, for you build the tombs of the prophets whom your ancestors killed. So you are witnesses and approve of the deeds of your ancestors, for they killed them, and you build their tombs. Therefore, also the wisdom of God said, 'I will send them prophets and apostles, some of whom they will kill and persecute, so that this generation may be charged with the blood of all the prophets shed since the foundation of the world, from the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, who perished between the altar and the sanctuary. Yes, I tell you, it will be charged against this generation. Woe to you lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You did not enter yourselves, and you hindered those who were entering.'" We've seen Jesus healing, teaching, loving, but now this. It becomes a little uncomfortable for us. Jesus has, in this passage, introduced the first of the four C's, conflict. Let's take a closer look at this conflict that Luke describes. First, who were these Pharisees and the experts of the law that Jesus was speaking to? In Jewish society, they were the most respected. They were very, very influential in the society. They were the religious leaders, and everyone looked up to them. Everyone admired them. They had a great knowledge of scriptures because they had spent their entire lives studying. They worked hard to defend the word of God and the law of Moses. They defended it with passion. They felt that every single word of scripture was sacred and that it had to be kept pure, kept free of any corruption. They saw themselves as the guardians of the truth, defenders of God's honor and glory. In fact, they considered themselves the gatekeepers of God's kingdom. And because of their influence in the society, the community saw them in the same way. And so, as gatekeepers, they felt very much threatened and offended by the words Jesus was saying. In fact, by all of the words Jesus was saying, they saw his ministry here as an opposition to their own. They saw it as a danger to the traditions that they kept so sacred. And so they began to stand against Jesus at every step. They became, as we follow them through the Gospels, his chief opposition. Quite often, as we see them, Jesus pretty much ignores them. Jesus preaches, he teaches, he heals, he spreads the news that God's kingdom is at hand. But then in today's passage, Jesus pushes back. He's not pushing back to win an argument with them. He's pushing back in order to confront their hypocrisy. The Pharisees, as the gatekeepers of the kingdom, have essentially slammed the gates of heaven in people's faces. What they don't realize is that in doing this, they've shut these gates on themselves also. They don't understand the kind of kingdom that Jesus plans to introduce to the world. So when Christ pushes back, the tensions begin to rise. The conflict becomes confrontation. Jesus is speaking out here against a broken system. The gentle Jesus, meek and mild, suddenly becomes a tiger. I think that most of us would really prefer to see a more agreeable Jesus, a Jesus who would be polite to his hosts, a Jesus who would try to reconcile instead of trying to irritate his hosts. But it's important for us to realize that Jesus just doesn't work that way. Jesus won't sit back quietly when he sees injustice. The French philosopher Voltaire said, "Ever since God made humanity in his image, we've been trying to return the favor." In other words, we really want to make a God that fits our plans instead of us having to fit his. We try to do it with Jesus all the time. We would like to create a Jesus that we just take out of the box on Sunday morning for an hour and worship him and then put him back in a box so we can go on with our regular lives during the week. We want Jesus to think like us. We want him to believe what we believe. We want him to vote like us. We want him to value what we value. We want him to hate what we hate. We want a Jesus whose priorities match our own. We want a Jesus who accepts our opinions as truth and who never challenges our own convictions. And so, when we see this Jesus in our gospel passage today, it can be a little unsettling. On the other hand, there are some of us who probably really like to see this kind of Jesus. They're happy to see the confrontational behavior. These kinds of passages excite us. We cheer him on when we hear him attacking the Pharisees. We want to see even more fire and brimstone. We see these Pharisees and the lawyers and we say, they got it coming. Give it to them, Jesus. But if we like this Jesus, because we think it gives us a free pass to be confrontational ourselves, to say whatever crosses our mind at the time, the truth is that Jesus then is speaking to our own hypocrisy, just as he's speaking to the Pharisees. The truth is that Jesus doesn't just tell it like it is, Jesus shows us how it should be. As he speaks to these Pharisees, he warns them about what not to do. But he also, through his life, shows us what we must do. In order to live like him, we have to take that confrontation and turn it into compassion. The Pharisees considered themselves as the gatekeepers, but Jesus is the gate. Jesus has all the authority, and he uses that authority to challenge the Pharisees. Throughout his time on earth, he extends this compassion to the most unlikely people, even extending it to his own enemies. As we've seen, the Pharisees became his most vocal opponents. and he even treats them generally with compassion and love. One of our favorite and most familiar Bible verses of all is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And who did he speak that verse to? Nicodemus, a Pharisee. As Nicodemus, frightened about what his friends, his colleagues, his public might think of him, comes to Jesus in the dark of night, Jesus shows him this compassion. He shows him that the gates of the kingdom are swung wide open for everyone. When we see this truth, we see that Jesus' words to the Pharisees and the lawyers were actually an act of compassion, not of confrontation. They were meant to shock these people into actually doing something, into seeing the truth of Jesus' kingdom. And that brings us from confrontation to compassion, and now to a challenge. It's hard for us to accept that Jesus brings compassion to these hypocrites, these Pharisees. They represent all the flaws, everything that is wrong with the religious system of their time. But hypocrisy among the self-proclaimed religious isn't limited to the Pharisees. We see it in our own time, in our own society. We see Christians who abuse their power. We see Christians who preach love but practice hate. We see people who use the name of Christ for their own personal gain. The Pharisees were so intent on preserving the law and of making sure that everyone else did the same that they forgot the two most important parts of that law: love God and love your neighbor. The Pharisees, sadly, aren't alone. We see too many people around us neglecting these gospel commandments. And wouldn't we just love to slam the gates of heaven in the faces of these hypocrites today? And yet if we do, we end up slamming it in our own faces as well. Jesus responds to these people with compassion and with love. Our challenge is to do the same. Instead of slamming shut the gate, our job is to help hold it wide open. This is what Jesus tells us if we truly listen to him. Amen.
Wings, there you are, the breath nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall around you, near you, it shall not come. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. Command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand, and hold you in the palm of his hand.
Let us pray. God of strength and comfort, in the quiet calm of your presence, we pause in this storm of concerns that surrounds us. We set aside our own interests and distractions to pray for the world that you love. Today, we remember before you all people in their daily life and work, our families, our friends, our neighbors, those that we work with, and those whose faces we might recognize because we see them regularly, but people we really don't know. Be with all who find these times stressful or exhausting. We remember before you these congregations, our presbytery, and congregations of other traditions near us, as well as those who serve in church leadership and all who nurture faith in others. Help us to support each other and look to the future with hope. We pray for this community, our country, and governments throughout the world, as well as all those who work for justice, freedom, and peace. Send your Spirit, the Advocate, to speak for the voiceless and to challenge injustice. Today, we continue to offer our prayers along with the prayers of the world for the people of Ukraine. Be with them in this time of need, of oppression, of danger. protect them, and help the world find ways to bring about a lasting peace. We pray for victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression, for all who struggle to rebuild their communities after natural disaster and the effects of this pandemic, and for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. Bring them comfort and courage and the support of their neighbors. And we pray for those people and situations on our hearts and minds this day. Hear us now as we pray in the words that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. support the weak, help the afflicted, honor everyone, love and serve the Lord. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all today and every day of your life. Amen.